this. Okay, so part two of the Mahdi's. Okay, so comparing the biblical Antichrist and the Mahdi. This is the key part. If you're going to take any notes, take them now. Again, I'm using some notes from this book because I've already checked them all out and they're all legit. Okay, so most people who haven't even read the Bible have heard of the man popularly known as the Antichrist. Simply put, according to the Bible, the Antichrist will be Satan's primary human agent on the earth in the last days. Interestingly, the Bible refers to him only once by that specific name in 1 John chapter 2, verse 18. Using other names, however, there are numerous references to the Antichrist found throughout the Bible. Some of the various names that Scripture assigns to him are the beast, the abomination that causes desolation, the desolator, the man of sin, the man of lawlessness, the son of destruction, the little horn, the Assyrian, the oppressor, the king of Babylon, and even the mysterious God. There are several other names that Scripture uses to refer to the Antichrist as well. But beyond all of his unusual names, who exactly is the Antichrist? After describing the first three beasts in the book of Daniel, Daniel says this, and this is Daniel chapter 7, verse 7 and 8. After this, in my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was a fourth beast, terrifying and frightening and very powerful. It had large iron teeth. It crushed and devoured its victims and trampled underfoot whatever was left. It was different from all the former beasts as it was left. It was different from all the other former beasts, and it had 10 horns. While I was thinking about the horns, there before me was another little horn, which came up among them, and three of the first horns were uprooted before it. This horn had eyes like the eyes of a man, and the mouth that spoke boastfully. In verse 15 and 16, Daniel was troubled in the spirit, and the vision that passed through my head disturbed me. I approached one of those standing there and asked him the true meaning of all this. So he told me and gave me interpretation of these things. The four great beasts are four kingdoms that will rise from the earth. Now remember, we talked earlier, Islam believes in four different kingdoms that will come in Islam. We read that the first time. It says, it's actually pretty straightforward. Daniel again asks the angel specifically about the four beasts, and in particular about the little horn that uprooted three horns. The angel again responds this with a very direct and clear explanation. He gave me this explanation. This is Daniel chapter 7, verses 23-24. He gave me this explanation. The fourth beast is a fourth kingdom that will appear on earth. It will be different from all the other kingdoms and will devour the whole earth, trampling it down and causing and crushing it. The 10 horns are 10 kings who will come from this kingdom. After them, another king will arise different from the earlier ones. He will subdue three kings. Essentially, the angel explains that the fourth kingdom causes great destruction to the whole earth. In the last part of Daniel chapter 7, the angel describes to Daniel the actions of this king as well as his end. He will speak against the Most High and oppress his saints and try to change the set times and laws. The saints will be handed over to him for a time, times, and half a time, but the court will sit and his power will be taken away completely and be completely destroyed forever. Daniel 7, verses 25 to 27. The king is said to oppress the saints of God for a period of time that the Bible scholars agree is 3.5 years or 7 years, through time, times, and half a time, depending on your peace agreement, understanding, and your views. But eventually this dominion will be taken away and replaced by the kingdom of the Most High God. The Bible establishes the fact that the Antichrist will be a spiritual leader whose authority will be acknowledged worldwide. After examining the Antichrist's role as a universal religious leader, many Bible prophecy teachers have talked about the coming of the one world religion, or the false church, which the Antichrist will both create and enforce upon the entire earth. This concept of the coming dominion and demonically inspired world religion is partly arrived at due to the frequent references to worship associated with the Antichrist throughout Scripture. Likewise, it almost goes without saying, the Mahdi of Islam will be a leader of worldwide worship movement. A worship movement that will seek to cause anyone who practices any other religion other than Islam to renounce his faith and worship the God of Islam. The Mahdi, quote, will govern the people by sunnah of their prophet and establish Islam on earth, and Islam will be victorious over all the religions. That is the Quran. Thus we see that the Mahdi leads a world revolution that will institute a new world order. Based on the religion of Islam, Islam will be the only religion allowed. Both the Antichrist and the Mahdi are said to be the unqualified leaders of a global religious movement that will draw worship away from God of the Bible and his son Jesus Christ. Inherent in the worship of their God in Islam, within the context of Islam, is a direct denial of the God of the Bible and his son Jesus Christ. In fact, this is the reason that some Muslims feel so strongly as to say that the Mahdi, quote, will eradicate those pigs and dogs, the Christians and Jews who refuse to convert to Islam, which leads us to the next obvious similarity between the Antichrist and the Mahdi. Another prophetic passage of Scripture, rich with symbolic language, initially is slightly difficult to understand, but after the symbols are explained, it becomes very clear. A great and wondrous sign appeared in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and a crown of 12 stars on her head. Revelation chapter 12, verse 1. The woman, symbolically pictured here, is the family and the nation of Israel, the Jewish people. We see that she is crowned with 12 stars. This represents the 12 sons of Israel, who became the 12 tribes that make up the family or the nation of Israel. See Genesis 35, verses 23 to 26, which will give you that proper interpretation based on Joseph's dream of the 12 stars bowing down to him. Is basically represents his 12 brothers, the 12 tribes, Bible. The Scripture always interprets the Scripture, so we're not pulling stuff out of the air. We're just making sure that we match Scripture with Scripture so we have the right interpretation here. She was pregnant and cried out in pain, and she was about to give birth. Then another sign appeared in heaven, and an enormous red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns on his heads. The dragon stood in front of the woman who was about to give birth so that he might devour her child the moment it was born. She gave birth to a son, a male child, who will rule all nations with an iron scepter, and her child was snatched up to God and to his throne. Revelation 12, verses 2 through 5. The woman, being Israel, becomes pregnant and gives birth to a male child who will rule all the nations with an iron scepter. This is a clear reference to Jesus, the Jewish Messiah. You can also find this in Psalm verse 2, or chapter 2, verse 1. The dragon mentioned here is identified in verse 9. The ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. We see that Satan desires to kill Jesus, but instead Jesus is snatched up to God and to his throne. This is a reference to Jesus' ascension to heaven after the resurrection in Acts 1:8. We see that Satan is enraged at the woman, went off to make war against the rest of her offspring, those who obey God's commandments and hold to the testimony of Jesus. Israel's other offspring are those Christians who indeed obey God's commandments and hold to the testimony of Jesus. This is the only passage that makes specific reference to Satan making a direct target to both Jews and Christians. Why did we read this? Because we're identifying the mission of Satan and the mission of Antichrist. The mission of Antichrist is to attack children of God, Israel, and the spiritual children of God, the followers of Jesus Christ. Okay? That is his mission on earth. Wipe out the Jews, and you wipe out the testimony. You get rid of the testimony, there's no foundation for the Christian faith, you get rid of the Christians as well. That's why they want to destroy sites in Israel. That's why they want control of Israel. Get rid of it. It never happened. Wipe it off the map. This is what the Quran says the Mahdi will do, knowing what I just told you. Interestingly enough, Islamic traditions speak much of the Mahdi's special calling to convert Christians and Jews to Islam, yet speaks very little specifically of conversions from other faiths. It seems as though converting Christians and Jews to Islam will be the primary evangelistic thrust of the Mahdi. The following quote from Amini, an Islamic scholar, clearly articulates this vision. Quote, "The Mahdi will offer the religion of Islam to the Jews and Christians. If they accept it, they will be spared. Otherwise, they will be killed." And of course, we cannot forget the infamous hadith that has become a favorite of many Muslim anti-Semites. Again, note that it's speaking specifically about the last hour or the end times. The last hour will not come unless the Muslims will fight against the Jews, and the Muslims would kill them until the Jews would hide themselves behind a stone and a tree, and a stone or a tree would say, "Muslims or servants of their God, or servants of the Islamic God, there is a Jew behind me, come and kill him." But the tree, Garkad, would not say, for it is the tree of the Jews. After commenting on this particular hadith, several Muslim authors will quickly point out that the very interesting fact that this particular tree, the Garqua, apparently the boxwood tree, is presently being planted in abundance by Jews in Israel. The point is that Muslims expect the final Holocaust to take place within the present state of Israel. This, of course, corresponds to another very specific similarity between the biblical Antichrist and the Mahdi. The context here is a messianic person, messiah figure of Islam, is to rule and reign from Jerusalem. I want you to think about this in context to the current war and the current status of the Middle East. Not that it's been much different, but it's getting significantly Islamic. Muhammad said this, "There will be four peace agreements between you and the Romans, and the Christians, the Jews. The fourth will be mediated through a person who will be from the progeny of Aaron, Honorable Aaron, the brother of Moses, and will be upheld for 7 years. The people asked, O Prophet Muhammad, who will be the imam, the leader of the people at that time? The Prophet said, he will be from my lineage and will be exactly 40 years of age. His face will shine like a star." That is the Quran. Another key aspect of the Mahdi. For those of you that weren't here, we discussed the biblical calendar. Okay? We talked about the Bible is written on a lunar calendar, not a solar calendar. Okay? God has his own time. Yes, he does. God has his own time frame and his own calendar. Islam has their own time frame and their own calendar. Interesting. Because the Mahdi, when he comes, will change the global calendar to an Islamic calendar. Do we have anything in Scripture that says the Antichrist will do so? Daniel chapter 7, verse 25. "He, the Antichrist, will speak against the Most High and oppress his saints and try to change the set times, dates, and laws. The saints will be handed over to him for time, times, and half a time." The Mahdi will set up an Islamic calendar where they will do their Ramadan fast and their different things. The Antichrist will change God's calendar. Interesting. It is considered a divine command to use the Hijra calendar with 12 purely lunar months without intercalculation, as evident from the Holy Quran, or the Quran. We got one more part. The rider on the white horse. The final similarity between the Antichrist and the Mahdi that will be discussed is the fact that both the Antichrist and the Mahdi are identified with the biblical passage that describes a rider on a white horse. While this could be literal, it is most probably a symbolic picture of the two men. The amazing thing is that the origin of the biblical tradition of the Antichrist on a white horse and the origin of the Islamic tradition of the Mahdi on a white horse come from the same passage in the Bible. The basis for the symbolic picture of both the Antichrist and the Mahdi on a white horse is the sixth chapter of the book of Revelation. Here the Apostle John describes his vision of the release of the events that mark the beginning of the end of times. The picture is of Jesus holding a scroll. On the outside of the scroll are seven wax seals. The breaking of each seal releases a specific and distinct end time event. It says, I watched as the Lamb, Jesus, opened the first of the seven seals. Then I heard one of the four living creatures say in a voice like thunder, come, I looked, and there before me was a white horse. Its rider held a bow, and he was given a crown, and he rode out as a conqueror bent on conquest. Revelation 6, verses 1 and 2. The seals that follow this rider are peace is taken from the earth, famine, plagues and death, persecution and martyrdom of God's people, and a great earthquake. So we see that after the rider appears on the scene, the world essentially free falls into the chaos that defines the last hour. The interpretation that many Bible scholars apply to this passage is thus, the white horse is an imitation of the white horse that Jesus will ride when he returns in Revelation 19:11. Thus, the rider is an imitation Christ, an imposter, an antichrist. The bow without arrows that the rider carries represents a false peace. The rider carries with his rise to power a false promise of peace. This is in alignment with and may be a direct reference to the false peace treaty that the Antichrist makes with Israel at the start of the seven-year period of his rule. The crown on his head obviously refers to his position of authority and leadership. And we see that the true motivation and bent of the rider is to conquer. In light of the identity and activity of the rider, then we are not surprised to find out that the event that follows his emergence onto the world scene do not bring an age of peace, but rather an age of apocalyptic chaos. Apparently, this is not a problem for the Islamic scholars, who generally adopt a very arbitrary pick-and-choose approach to the Bible. For in seeing the Antichrist on the white horse with a crown and conquering, Muslim scholars see a picture of the Mahdi. As mentioned in the earlier chapter of the Mahdi, the earlier Muslim transmitter, Habar is quoted saying, I find the Mahdi recorded in the books of the prophets. For instance, the book of Revelation says, and I saw and behold a white horse. He sat on him, went forth conquering and to conquer. So we see that several of the most unique and distinguishing aspects of the biblical Antichrist person, mission, and actions are matched to quite an amazing degree by the descriptions of the Mahdi as found in the Islamic traditions. And now even further, we see that Muslim scholars actually apply Bible verses about the Antichrist to their awaited Savior, the Mahdi. This must be quite ironic, if not entirely prophetic.
Alex, can you give me an extra screen, please?
In short, comparison. The Bible's Antichrist and the Quran's 12th Imam, the Mahdi. The Antichrist kills Jews and Christians, so does the Mahdi. The Antichrist rules for 7 years, so does the Mahdi. He breaks a peace agreement, so does the Mahdi in the Quran. He has a one-world system. The Imam starts a caliphate, which is a one-world system under Sharia law in Islam. The Antichrist rules from the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. According to the Quran, the Mahdi will rule from the Temple Mount in Jerusalem. According to the Bible, the Antichrist beheads non-followers of his belief system, his religion, his worship. According to the Quran, anyone who does not follow the Mahdi will be beheaded. I don't know about you, but I think we may have figured out who the Antichrist is, huh? The reason why I told you guys all this information is because it is relevant. Don't think that because you are in America, because you are in this country, that you are exempt from what's happening in the world. Don't sit here and lie to yourself that none of this applies to you. Well, the rapture is going to happen. We won't be here for that. Okay? That's the wrong mindset. Be prepared in season and out of season to give an answer. Okay? It doesn't say, don't worry about being prepared because the rapture is going to happen. Michael, shalom. My goodness, how are you? Wow. Surprise. That's okay. That's okay. Welcome. You're welcome. So don't think that because you're in America, you're exempt from what's happening in the Islamic world. There's an event that takes place in Dearborn, Michigan. It's an Arab festival. Does anybody know that Michigan is now, for the most part, under Sharia law in Dearborn? There are Christians that are going to this event to share Jesus in America, land of the free, home of the brave, you know, all that stuff we tell ourselves and delude ourselves with. You think you're exempt? I want to show you, and if there's any children in the room, please, you may not, if you have a problem with hard language, you're going to hear a little bit, okay? If anybody wants to take the kids, Eric is in the children's room, you're more than welcome to do that, but this is an event. This is Islam in Michigan. Michigan. Let me say it one more time. Michigan. Okay? These are Christians sharing their faith to Muslims at an Arab event in Michigan. Go ahead, Alex. Okay, let me explain the situation. This guy on the left is a Christian man, okay? He's at an Islamic event, sharing his faith. The police officer is coming up to him and telling him, basically, that he's starting a riot. Okay? Now here's the thing. He's going to address the police officer and say, hey, if they start rioting and throw bottles at us and throw things at us, what are you going to do? Well, you know, and then the police, go ahead, Alex.
I think you don't really want to pursue the law unless it's going to happen to us.
These are Muslim kids in Michigan throwing stuff at Christians. This is a public event. denied a free speech zone in Michigan.
There's officers that actually turn the other way. So if you have a local uniform, so I don't have a gun. There's 100,000 people coming to the hospital about 25 to 30 hours. There's just two officers here.
It gets worse.
So you're going to jeopardize free speech. You want to stop that?
If you think that you're exempt from their agenda, you're wrong. If you think that because you're in the United States, you're exempt, you're wrong. If you think that you're safe because you're not in the Middle East and you don't have to worry about what's going on, don't be stupid.
That's right.
God says his people perish for lack of knowledge. I'm telling you all this information, number one, not to scare you, number one, not to get you all worked up, but you need to know the world you live in.
That's right.
The times that you're in. You need to understand your position as a follower of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah. You need to understand the Antichrist spirit and test the Antichrist spirit in the world. They will cut your head off. They don't care. It's not a joke. It's not games. I'm not politically correct, and I don't plan on being politically correct. This is the world that we live in. I think that we need to pray, and we need to do the blessing, because we're already over our time. So let's just pray real fast. Father God, we come before you and we thank you, Lord, for this information. Father, we thank you for making us aware, giving us a spirit of discernment. Father, teaching us your word, your scriptures. Father, just giving us everything that we need in our toolbox of the Holy Spirit to make clear decisions, to understand the world we live in, Father. Keep our eyes open to what you're trying to say. Keep our eyes open to the spirits around us. Help us to test the spirits, Father, so that we will know who is for you and against you. Teach us, Father, not to toss our pearls to pigs, but to allow your word to go and sow and allow it to produce a harvest in everybody here today. Father, it is so important, Lord, because there are thousands of Muslims daily that are seeing you, experiencing you, that are coming to you and coming to salvation in Messiah, Lord. And we just right now, we want to lift up Israel to you, Father. We want to lift up the nation of Israel. We want to lift up all of the soldiers, the families, our brothers and sisters that are affected, the government, Father, Benjamin Netanyahu. Father, we ask you to give them a spirit of wisdom. We ask you to give them truth, Father. We ask you to give them the knowledge and the information and the empowerment that they need, Father, to stand firm in this time. We know what's going to happen, Lord. You know what's going to happen, Father. But we need, Father, we need supernatural, full, Holy Spirit-driven lives in these last days, Father.
Yes.
And Father, we also lift up the Muslim and the Arab people to you. Father, the people affected by the war in Gaza. Father, the families that were killed on both sides of the aisle. Because you do not take death, you do not take pleasure in the death of the wicked. You wish that all should come to salvation. So Father, we ask you, Lord, that you would open the eyes of the Muslims and the Arabs and those that are against your land, your people, your son, your savior, and your redemptive plan. We ask you to open their eyes that they would come to salvation. That they would proclaim your kingdom boldly within the United States, within Canada, within America, within North America, South America, within the Middle East, within Europe, and all these places, Father, we ask you to send forth your spirit before them, as you did at the founding of the earth. You sent forth your spirit, your breath of life. Father, make those fields ready for your work. Father, give us everything. Allow us to be empowered, bold, and without division. Allow us to come together in unity and proclaim your kingdom. B'shem Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. We're going to do, for those of you that aren't normal for coming here, we do the traditional Aaronic blessing, which is the blessing that God told Aaron and the children of Israel. He told him to bless the congregations with this. So next Shabbat is next weekend. From here forth, the first Saturday and the third Saturday of every month, consistently. We have a set schedule now here. So it's the first Saturday and the third Saturday of every month. So if everybody will come up, we're going to hold hands. We're going to play the blessing, allow the blessing to bless each and every one of us. It'll be in Hebrew and then in English. And then you're all free to go. And I am not sorry for taking up all your time. And Alex is going to want to jump in here too, so.
If I stay up here in case it freezes.
I don't think it will. We haven't had any problems with that one. Okay. It should be fine.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
Thank you all for coming so much. I hope that you have learned something today. I hope that you're going to walk out of here with a new perspective on some things. And I'll see you next week. Yeah.
Hey buddy, how are you?
No, I've got the same number. We just
I know.
Our schedule's always different. Because we've been working around their schedule. So we get the Saturdays, but they're not here. So, well, they do something every second Saturday of the month. But because sometimes it's three Saturdays, sometimes it's four Saturdays, sometimes five, you know, you never really know what, you know, how many Saturdays and all that. So we've been working around their schedule. So now we actually
have
Now we're actually finally on the right track. Starting next month. So, first and third time.
loves that. So a lot of it is for this opportunity.
And like I said, I'm gonna, this is still on.